There is a war between the rich and poor, a war between the man and the woman. There is a war between the ones who say there is a war and the ones who say that there isn't. Why don't you come on back to the war? That's right, get in it. Why don't you come on back to the war? It's just
hello, everybody.
Beginning.
This is Michael Delius for the 20th taping of the podcast, Prosperity Marxism. We're very pleased today with my co-host, Peter Bratsis, and of course, the producer, Joshua Calbo, to present a very comprehensive, a splendid and magisterial summary of the Althusserian legacy with Panagiotis Sotiris, our Greek friend, comrade from Athens, who is a professor, adjunct lecturer at the Open University in Athens. He's a journalist, which I see in his style, a very good writer, the journalistic background, that everyday practice really shines in the book, as well as a member of the editorial board of Historical Materialism. And we welcome him for a discussion of his new book, relatively new book, published in 2020 and hardbound, entitled A Philosophy for Communism, Rethinking Althusser. And this was published originally by Brill in the Historical Materialism series, and then has been reissued in paperback last year, 2021, in Haymarket. And I really encourage the audience to purchase this book and read it seriously. It is a major contribution as both a commentary and a historical problematization of the Althusserian legacy. So we're going to talk about the book a little bit. I'll try to set it up, and then we'll let maybe Panagiotis speak to the motivation for the book, his longtime encounter, if you will. We can use that word, encounter with Althusser. And then Peter certainly has questions about the relevance of the Althusserian politics for today, or what is the practice of politics that Althusser has left us with. And, you know, and of course that will open up problems in theoretical practice and class struggle in theory, some of the mainstays and main themes. So anyway, I'm gonna begin. First of all, I was really taken by the quote, which I think was very, very accurately pointed as an epigram to the book from the great Turkish poet Nazım Hikmet. From September, 25th, was it, Peter? 1945, a poem.
1945.
And the quote that Panagiotis begins with is, "The most beautiful sea hasn't been crossed yet." And this may sum up very well in one line what the Althusserian legacy may be. We have maybe not crossed fully this great, great, massive contribution to the beginnings of a Marxist and really a materialist philosophy, you know, as we go forward, and a materialist practice in a political theory. So anyway, I think Panagiotis began really looking at what kind of philosophy, what kind of practice could be useful for what he would call social change or transformation, and emancipation. And this revisiting, rethinking Althusser after many years of an encounter begins in three different parts. The first part is a structure, conjuncture, and the encounter, in which the many, many levels of the Althusserian engagement with the history of philosophy and this wondrous new reading of the history of philosophy is taking place, much, much more than just rethinking Marx or the reading capital from which Althusser is most famous, at least in the English-speaking world. You know, his encounters with figures such as Montesquieu, Rousseau, Pascal, of course Spinoza, of course Marx, and then of course Freud and others. You know, Panagiotis goes through, you know, some of the main figures in or the main themes of Althusserian philosophy: structure, the notion of structure, structure and dominance, and he can speak to this, conjecture, and of course, the ultimate, what he considers, and I think there's some irony here and some ambivalence about what has been termed the Althusserian turn around the encounter and aleatory materialism. And so we will go there as well. I want to also maybe concentrate a little bit on one chapter that I found profoundly interesting, chapter 9 of the book, which is Spinoza in Althusser as a laboratory. We were all Spinozaists, was the phrase that they used that in the late 60s after the Reading Capital Group became quite famous, and where you have a movement from to latent structures from structure, right? In some ways, you know, to the latent structures in the late 60s as a new term that is used. And the schemes of the generalities 1, 2, and 3 and how that is operating in Althusser's thinking. Then also, I think we should go through the new practice of philosophy somewhat. But let me take a step back for a second. The amazing thing to me, the first thing that one is struck as a reader who has some background in Althusser or anything to do with Marxist philosophy is the breadth of Panagiotis's, recapturing of all the scholars around Althusser, the Althusserians, if you will, the critics, as well as the people that were extensions of Althusser. He begins with, if you will, the E.P. Thompson poverty of theory, the claim against, you know, Althusser's lack of empiricism, theoretism, et cetera, the evicting of process from history, the static conceptions of history. And then he goes into, at the same time, two other figures who were very influenced by Althusser, Ted Benton's Rise and Fall of Structural Marxism, as well as, of course, Kalinikos's book on Marxism and philosophy, which is a testament, almost an oratory hagiography of Althusser to a point until Kalinikos went back on this somewhat when he wrote later Marxism and Philosophy in the 80s. So again, he goes through the literature extremely well. Gregory Elliott, I saw one person I used to know is omitted, maybe I missed it, Michael Springer, who was part of the comparative literature crowd at SUNY Stony Brook back in the day, who picked up on Althusser for the American context. Although you do mention, I know William Lewis, I think it is, as well as, and I didn't see Andrew Parker, who did some work also on Althusser as part of the diacritics crowd of the 1980s, who revisited the famous issue being Marx after Derrida, which was a very interesting thing. So anyway, I don't want to, keep going on, but, we could do is highlight some of the main contributions of Althusser, the vocabulary. In my own case, I entered Althusserian practice, by word of mouth back in the late 60s when I was a student at Tulane University, had heard of him. It was a kind of legend that was circulating in the 60s. And then Screen magazine sort of convinced me, the film magazine, that Althusserian practice, especially the work on ideology and ideological state apparatus, had a tremendous influence on film studies. And this was my way in before I started to read him seriously as a philosopher. To me, the seminal essays, at least in my background, were on the materialistic dialectic and contradiction and overdetermination. And of course, the beautiful chapters of Reading Capital, and especially the concept of historical time, which to me was very, very interesting, having been someone that was studying time and philosophy. So I'll turn it over to Panagiotis, and thank you so much for this wonderful contribution. For me, it was a pleasure to read. I don't usually like reading great commentary, summary, and arguments this way, but this was really a remarkably well-written, well-rounded, and very comprehensive work. And, I have one point to raise with you in terms of an exclusion, but we'll get to that after you speak. So please. Yeah.
Okay. Well, first of all, thanks a lot for this, your kind words and your very kind exaggerations.
Right.
Anyway, I tried. I mean, this book was not actually meant to be, and it does not. It's not its aim to be a kind of a comprehensive monograph on Althusser.
Right.
Actually, it started as a way to return to Althusser. I did my PhD on Althusser in the late 1990s in Greece. And I started returning to Althusser later by means of, you know, writing articles, conferences, etc. And then I realized that all this material could somehow be turned into a book. So this was based. And the idea behind the book is mainly its title. It's the idea that there's a very political character in philosophy for Althusser, in philosophy in general. This is how Althusser treats philosophy, and also in his own particular philosophical endeavor, his own attempt to rethink not just a materialist philosophy or a dialectical philosophy, but actually to see what kind of philosophical practice can enhance the struggle for social emancipation, the struggle for communism. And that's mainly the idea behind the three, let's say, parts of the book. One part of the book is around three notions: structure, conjecture, and the encounter. This, in a certain way, is a return to Althusser's highly original contribution to what we usually term historical materialism. The interesting thing is that, I mean, Althusser has received lots of polemics over the years. The usual accusation is that he was a structuralist, with this meaning a kind of, structures determining human action, not leaving any space for agency or human potential, which is very far from what Althusser was actually trying to do. Althusser was not, a structuralist in the manner of, Claude Lévi-Strauss. His idea was not to create some kind of grammar of social relations. His idea was more to rethink what is the originality of Marxism in regards to thinking social totality. And he tried to draw lines of demarcation against what he defines as theoretical humanism, which perhaps is the essence of Althusser's so-called structuralism. And I stressed the word theoretical in humanism. It's not a question of a practical theoretical anti-humanism, in the sense that we cannot have a social theory or a theory of history that is based on some kind of transhistorical human essence. This is because this leads us to a kind of metaphysics and also to a teleology. So Althusser is also strongly anti-historicist, against any form of teleology. So how can we think of social totality in its complexity, which is not the simple idea that economy dictates everything, the kind of crude economism associated with Soviet Marxism? How to rethink the specificity of politics, while at the same time remaining with the contours of a Marxist conception of the primacy of class struggle and the primacy of, struggles around social production and production. So all this, and this is what explains all these very original contributions of Althusser, this idea of the overdetermination, which is exactly how to think the complexity of social totality, and also the complexity of the conjecture, which basically, although Althusser supposedly talks about structures, in reality, the very emergence of the Althusserian project in contradiction and overdetermination mainly talks about the conjecture. What is a conjecture? What is this an historical moment? How do different dynamics can be articulated? And I think this is a very highly original materialism, which Althusser tried to elaborate in the first set of his contributions. I think that this kind of anti-historicist, anti-theological dynamic is a common thread running through his work, and he also tried to be very, very self-critical about it, which is also a very fascinating aspect of Althusser, this constant effort of self-criticism. for example, even long before the international audiences and the French audience were able to grasp the force of his original contributions, the 1965 books for Marx and the collective reading capital, Althusser already in 1966-67 is self-criticizing his own positions, mainly trying to avoid any thinking of, let's say, deep or latent structures. So this is his idea that moving towards a more open conception of the conjecture, which ends up in the notion of the encounter, a notion that we can already find in his works in the second half of the 1960s. Already this notion emerges in 1967, and then much more elaborated in unpublished manuscripts of the 1970s. Now, this idea of the encounter is exactly the idea that there's nothing predetermined in how social relations are formed. Social structures or social forms are encounters that manage to last, but at the same time, in a certain way, they are contingent. They are defined by the dynamics of the antagonisms that traverse them, and in particular, class struggle. And I think this is a very interesting, fascinating, and open conception of historical, of historical future, without any sense of teleology, without, one might say, the convenience offered by very strong forms of determinism and teleology, but also more open to historical change. Now, this is something that Althusser tried to develop even later in the 1980s. It's an interesting aspect, and I try to go through this aspect in the book, that although we learned in a certain way most of aleatory materialism, of the materialism of the encounter in the 1990s, when the first posthumous editions started to appear in French and later in English. And they were mainly texts from the 1980s, a period of personal tragedy for Althusser and isolation, and texts overdetermined by this particular situation. We gradually realized, as more and more texts were coming out of the Althusserian archive, that this was a conception, the materialism of the encounter, already developed in the 1970s. The manuscripts that you mentioned, A Philosophy for Non-Philosophers, or How to Be a Marxist in Philosophy, these are big manuscripts from the 1970s, and they have a fully developed conceptualization of, let's say, the materialism of the encounter. The same goes for Althusser's well-known book, Machiavelli and Us, also written in the 1970s, a manuscript basically ready for publication, remained unpublished, published in English in 1999. So this also helps us in another aspect, because Althusser in the 1970s, when he fully moves into this conception of, materialism of the encounter, is also the more political Althusser. It's the Althusser that has a much more publicly pronounced criticism of the French and international communist movement, a left-wing criticism of it. So it's interesting to see this dialect. So the first part of the book is mainly trying to see this philosophical itinerary. And at the same time, as you mentioned, I incorporate Althusser's many encounters with other philosophers, which are very interesting. For example, Althusser comes from a Hegelian background. His, MA thesis is on Hegel, and it's a very good text on Hegel. And Althusser was really versed into a very French reading of Hegel. And so when he tried to insist in the 1960s that there is a kind of epistemological break between, the mature thinking of Marx and both earlier Hegelian and Feuerbachian elements, this is not a dogmatic, approach. In a certain way, Althusser has a certain knowledge of Hegel, of course. He later admits the relation is much more complex, but at that time, it was a kind of defense of the originality of Marxist thinking as a materialist thinking. So I also visit, as you mentioned, his encounter with Pascal. Althusser came also from a Christian background. So Pascal was a constant interlocutor also in questions of faith during the 1940s. But it's interesting that, of course, Pascal actually influenced Althusser, both in terms of in questions of philosophy of science, also in terms of this kind of anti-teleological thinking. The Pascalian wager can be read in this sense, but also in terms of a theory of ideology. It's well known that when Althusser tries to present an example of how ideology is out of social practice, and it's actually practice that creates ideological forms, he uses a quote, and not very, the quote is not very exact in Althusser's text, but it indeed comes from Pascal, the famous phrase that, well, if you kneel and you cross your hands, then you will believe in the end. So trying to present this yeah. this but image of how of how practice creates ideological form. But Pascal was important. Also Spinoza. Spinoza is one of, it's a very interesting question, because it is Althusser who suggests that. He says, we're not structuralists, we're Spinozists. And it's obvious that, and also it's very well known that Althusser's students became some of the more important contemporary experts on Spinoza. I will just mention Pierre Masseret and Etienne Balibar, to name just these two of them. But also Althusser always returned to Spinoza in various forms, and this is by itself interesting to see his dialogue with Spinoza. Sometimes he finds in Spinoza, let's say, more like a theory of ideology and a theory of science in the different kinds of knowledge. Other times he returns more to the more political aspects of Spinoza, but he's a constant interlocutor. The same goes from Rousseau. And I think that in regards to Rousseau, it's that Althusser's dialogue is very interesting, because Althusser returned to Rousseau. This came out of a practical necessity, because his part of his teaching duties was to prepare students for the aggregation, the entrance contest for education in France. So part of the syllabus was text from Rousseau. And you can see the evolution of Althusser's thinking by the way he is, his reading of Rousseau changes. And if, for example, in the 1970s, in the 1973 course, you can see Althusser using materialism of the encounter as a way to read Rousseau. But this is also something very interesting. So this about Althusser's interlocutors. So the second part of the book is dedicated to a question that sometimes is underestimated when we read Althusser. Althusser was one of those philosophers that really tried to think what it means to do philosophy, what it means to be a philosopher, what is philosophy apart from being, let's say, a department in universities. What is its specificity as a theoretical practice? And we know that originally Althusser in the 1960s flirts with the idea that we can have a kind of Marxist, let's say, philosophy of the science, scientific philosophy, that what he calls a theory of theoretical practice, that could be a theory of the knowledge effect, and in a certain way offer some guarantees of whether we have scientific knowledge or not. But he never reaches, I have to say, this point. Althusser never creates a theory of guarantees of scientificity. If you look at the introductory text of Reading Capital, which in a certain way it's the last text of the chronologically written, because he wrote it after all the other interventions have written, Althusser begins going into exactly that direction, and then the text stops in a certain way. We cannot have a theory of guarantees of knowledge. It is a kind of a tacit acceptance of this fact. But then Althusser tries to revisit this idea. He says, no, we cannot think of philosophy in this as a science of sciences or something that produces knowledge or produces truths. So he has this idea that philosophy is a different kind of practice. It's a kind of intervention. and also political intervention, or an intervention that represents class struggle in theory. And I think there's a very highly original conception of philosophy, because Althusser speaks at the same time that philosophy is inevitable, in the sense that whenever we have the encounter between knowledge or science and class antagonism, the questions that emerge take the form of philosophical questions, methodological, gnosiological, metaphysical, etc. But so, and philosophy in a certain way, it's an intervention. It tries to change a balance of forces. And at this, because exactly theoretical practice and political practice at the same time create conditions, let's say, for a spontaneous materialism, the confrontation with the materiality of the object of science or the materiality of class struggle. But at the same time, you have all the effects of the ideological level, ideology, which create forms of spontaneous idealism. So you have a kind of a battleground, and Althusser always liked the German word Kampfplatz, field of struggle, coming from Kant.
The place of struggle.
To describe exactly how different tendencies traverse. And so philosophy deals with that. Philosophy does not produce truths, it presents positions. These positions do not have a knowledge content, but they change the balance of forces. And I think this is a very fascinating approach, which in the end, in the 1970s, takes the form of his evocation of a new practice of philosophy that can accompany a new practice of politics, a kind of liberating philosophy that deconstructs idealist forms, deconstructs, let's say, the violence of the concept in a certain way, but also to liberate social practice. So this is a grand part of the book is dedicated to this, because I think it's a very, very important aspect of Althusser's attempt to redefine philosophy. And then I return to the question if there is an Althusserian politics. The title of the part is slightly ironic, because Althusser had written about the impossibility of Hegelian politics, the impossibility of having a room for politics in a Hegelian kind of Althusser's reading of Hegelian dialectics. But then my own question is whether there can also be an Althusserian politics. And I revisit Althusser's more political interventions. They're important, but also there are many shortcomings. Because Althusser was a very passionate thinker and a thinker that always thought about intervening in debates and taking the risks this includes. And his idea of political and theoretical intervention was a metaphor that he borrowed from a text by Lenin, which is bend the stick to the other side. So especially in the 1970s, Althusser has a great apprehension of the dangers associated with Eurocommunism, a kind of reformism or parliamentary conception of politics. So he really enters into this debate. Many of his interventions are clear-sighted, and let's say that historically they have been justified. If we look at the evolution of the European communist movement in the 1980s and its disintegration, others are, let's say, missed encounters. For example, there is a missed encounter between Althusser and Gramsci. Although Althusser originally was very influenced by Gramsci, and his original references to Gramsci in the early 1960s are very positive, but in the 1970s, he thinks that he reads Gramsci as a precursor of Eurocommunism, and you can see it in various manuscripts of that period. So I revisit this idea of the politics of Althusser's, we can read in terms of politics from Althusser's work. So I reach a conclusion that despite all these many shortcomings, contradictions, lacunae, tensions running through Althusser's work, he was indeed a thinker that tried exactly to think a philosophy for communism, to rethink both theory and philosophy under this exigency, to help and enhance movements and dynamics of social transformation. I think And this can explain the originality of Althusser and why we constantly return to his work, a work that was, most of it was written under difficult situation. Althusser throughout his life was suffering for a very severe form of depression, sometimes with psychotic elements. Whenever he wrote texts, he was a kind of hypomaniac situation, trying to write a very big manuscript in short time and then rejecting it or leaving it aside, etc., etc., which can account for the many unpublished manuscripts. But at the same time, there's always a richness. You always find things it's important to continue this dialogue. And that is why I started the text, let's say, with the problem, with the problematic reception in texts like E.P. Thompson's Poverty of Theory. I have the greatest respect for E.P. Thompson. I love his historical books. I think it's a very important contribution, in many ways compatible with what Althusser tried to exactly, a history from below, which is more open, a history of encounters. But when it came to writing this book, this was a bad book of polemics in my reading from the part of E.P. Thompson. Anyway, so yeah, that's...
As our friend Aronowitz used to say, the English are good plot summarizers, not especially good theorists. And they have a very difficult time with theory. And you actually cite Perry Anderson's In the Tracks of Historical Materialism and Considerations on Western Marxism as well. And Anderson's more of a capsulized account. It's nothing even close. And this is, again, why I think your work, and I understand what you're up to try to develop, revisit, revitalize, reconstitute Althusserian thinking and his legacy for a philosophy for communism. At the same time, I think you've done a great justice to understanding the presence of this thought historically and how it developed, evolved. And I think you're very, very good at taking away from that somehow there was this massive rupture in his thinking between the late 1960s to the 1990s. You seem to trace very nicely these evolutions of the thought, right? With the revolutionary self-criticism constantly going on. Yeah. So this is important.
Yeah, and you're right that we are now, we are like almost 60 years after the appearance of the first articles that defined Althusser as Althusser. And there have been layers and layers of reception of Althusser's work. And I think that now we can have a much more balanced approach, more open to dialogue, and we can engage in this dialogue. We're not in the polemic atmosphere of the 1960s. Although it has to be noted that, especially in France, Althusser's reception was liberating. If you talk with students of Althusser at that period, this idea, this conception of Marxism was liberating for them and it led to a flourishing of research, despite all the polemics that might have been at that period with other thinkers. And it's also interesting, since you mentioned the American reception of Althusser, and this is a kind of a research project that I'm trying to put together for many years, and it will take me many years, a history of Althusserianism is by itself lots of pages from the history of Marxism.
Yes.
Because absolutely. You have different traditions of Althusserianism in France, in Europe, in Greece. You have the American receptions, which are different receptions. It's a different generation. For example, it's one thing to discuss Michael Sprinker and this kind of reception. It's another reception, for example, the one from younger students now, PhD students working on Althusser. You have the Latin American reception of Althusser by itself, an entire theoretical tradition. So yes, this is also something that deserves to be studied more carefully.
The interesting thing in the United States, Althusser came in more through comparative literature programs and through the journal like Diacritics and some of the more quote unquote academic avant-garde publications, rather than through the philosophy departments or the, you know, other more traditional academic disciplines. So it's a kind of interesting that that happened in the United States. Also, Althusser was left out, even though I think he is the one who opened up the practice of reading that paved the way, of course, for Jacques Derrida and deconstruction, or at least French deconstruction, you know, that borrowed heavily from German deconstruction. But he at least, you know, opened up a new practice of reading, and he was eliminated from Textual Strategies, which was a handbook for many literary students during the 80s and 90s. Althusser was left out. He was excluded because of the communist affiliation. You know, the relationship to the party also hurt him very much, to the you know, Parti Communiste Français. You know, this really hurt. And again, the great misunderstanding that Althusser was always trying to please the party and at the same time trying to keep them theoretically advanced, right? That this was part of always the intervention. Again, I think produced a lot of misconceptions and misunderstandings of his work and the depth of it, you know.
So. Yeah, you're right on that. I mean, Althusser's relationship to the French Communist Party, it was always very complex. Althusser became a member of the Communist Party during the Cold War, in the early Cold War, and he remained a militant. For him, this was his political and intellectual milieu in a certain sense. He had the greatest respect for his comrades. At the same time, early on, he realized the limits of the parties, both politics and theory. And his, in a certain way, his early work is a kind of the idea that you can have, if you have a theoretical correction, then you can have a political correction. Gradually, he became more disillusioned with the party. This is obvious in his private correspondence, in various texts, until his open polemic, which came in the occasion of the party's abandonment of the notion of the dictatorship of the proletariat. Although he never took the step of leaving the party for reasons that perhaps this was his own personal, let's say, limits to do this kind of rupture. Other students of his did that. But it's obvious that he was always a very critical voice. He was never, one might say, this never a classical, you know, this idea that Althusser was a classical Stalinist. This was part of the polemics of the 1970s. Althusser was actually one of those theorists that attempted a left-wing criticism of Stalinism and Soviet Marxism and the very evolution of Soviet Union into an oppressive and exploitative regime. There is still this idea that he was a classical communist philosopher. No, he was a critical voice, and this is much more obvious now that we have the full spectrum of his work, including the unpublished manuscripts during his lifetime.
Right. I think also it's very important to note that the notion of intervention that you brought up, that Althusser, in a sense, in terms of the party or the philosophy for communism, one of the things that most impressive about him during the 60s was this talk that he gave to the French Philosophy Society for introduced by Jean Hippolyte, where he comes in and he gives a talk on Lenin's importance for philosophy, right? Which shook up everybody. Nobody had ever heard this or taken it seriously. So this was maybe the first intervention that, you know, determined Louis Althusser as being the outsider, if you will, that's going to bring to the academy, you know, the Leninist rupture, if you will, and a kind of new thinking about philosophy as a practice, right? In so many ways. So,
yeah. This is the Lenin and Philosophy Lecture by itself. It's a very important book, and it's exactly the book that encapsulates the first part of Althusser's rethinking of philosophical practice. And it is there that introduces this idea that philosophy is always a practice of philosophy. So I think it's very interesting that you have this practical conception of philosophy, which not in the sense exactly that philosophy intervenes, that philosophy intervenes in the contradictions surrounding both theoretical and political practice. As I mentioned, in a certain way, what Althusser suggests is that the cognitive aspects of both science and politics, combined with the constant, effectivity of the ideological, all this, the contradictions that emerged from these encounters, all the open questions, are what we tend to describe as philosophical programs. And philosophy's role is exactly to try to, offer some kind of coherence and creating a certain balance of force. Idealist philosophy in favor of idealism, and materialist philosophy in favor of materialism. Although Althusser is very careful not to suggest that idealist or materialist philosophies are those that self-define as idealist or materialist. In contrast, this has to do with their actual, effectivity. That's why Althusser, when he rethinks his idea of what are the materialist philosophers, he might include someone like, Epicurus or Lucretius. Exactly. Why? Because there is anti-teleology. If the anti-teleology is for Althusser, materialism for excellence, because it's also important to know that when Althusser refers to materialism, this is not just, crude physicalism. It's not the notion of materialism sometimes associated in Anglo-Saxon philosophy, that materialism is when you treat, cognitive functions as materially based functions. No, materialism for Althusser is the absence of teleology, is the idea that material processes, which also include social processes or ideological processes or language, are processes defined by their own terms, dynamics, and one might say dialectic, and there's nothing, either metaphysical background or some teleological horizon to them. So this is when which I think is also very important, because it's always a very historical conception of materialism, one that always has this openness. And I think what I like about Althusser is exactly that the very notion of the encounter, it's not just about bringing contingency in, because one might say, listen, yes, but if you go into the aleatory aspect, then you end up with contingency. Contingency means chance. And, communism should not be just a wager. It has to be something that you can work, and if you work, you can achieve it. And I think that what Althusser tried suggested, that it's exactly this idea that it is a process, that it's always at stake. It can always move to the other direction, but it's always the possibility that you can have good encounters, positive encounters. And this means the possibility of transformation. And of course, this is a very Spinozist conception, in the sense that it's exactly Spinoza who suggests that what we term bodies are in fact composite bodies. So they are encounters. They can be reformed. We can have new encounters, therefore new social forms, which is exactly, what is communism if not, the idea that we can have a collective ingenuity, innovation, and experimentation in regards to creating new social forms beyond the exigencies and the imperatives of the market.
Yes, no, very, very well put. And I like the way you present Althusser against the physicalist tradition of the Plekhanovs to the Dubrovin of the Soviet schools of philosophy too, that he's very well aware of this in terms of his open dialectic, anti-teleological and anti-physicalist only materialism. That's very, very well, very well done. I'm gonna, this is great, and we have so much to talk about, and we'll certainly do more of this, but I'm gonna turn it over to Peter, because I think he wants to situate some of the politics vis-a-vis maybe the Greek situation. I'll let Peter speak for himself, but maybe where this comes from. So he'll take up.
Maybe we can go back, I think, first to the reception history of Althusser, because when I discovered Althusser as a student in the late 80s, being in the United States, in Baltimore, the university, it had already become quite passé, Althusser and many of his peoples. then. And from what I know, also in France, it had vanished in a very stark way from the debates and the ongoing developments in political theory and philosophy and so forth. The same was not true in Greece. I think, and it's an interesting story why that's the case, and certainly was not the case in Latin America, where the structural Marxist, for lack of a better term, tradition has been a major force since the late 60s onwards. And there was nothing new coming out of Althusser for a long time. I think Michael Springer's edited volume, The Althusserian Legacy, was the first that had come out for a long, long time that was something new, looking back on the contributions of Althusser and the Althusserians. Since then, things have changed in a very significant way. So my first question, and certainly, Panagiotis, your book would not have been possible to be published, in English at least, were this, 1992 as opposed to 2022. So my first question is, why is this the case? What was it about Althusser that allowed for the, either why there was such a taboo or a forgetting of the Althusserian contributions for those decades, the 80s and 90s? Or what about Althusser made it so that this comeback was possible? Was it the new works being published, being rediscovered and published? Was there something there that was of great utility that people eventually returned to and found value there? What do you think is the source of this?
Well, this is an interesting and difficult question, because as you mentioned, I come from a different intellectual background. In a certain way, there remained a reading of Althusser in Greece from the late 1970s to the 1980s. I was also a student in the 1980s. Which was basically a political reading. It's very interesting that Althusser was considered a reference point in those segments of the Greek, let's say, radical left that tried to criticize the official communist movement. So people would, for example, we would read the ideology and ideological apparatus of the state as a way to criticize university and the non-neutrality of science and knowledge, and we would read his interventions in the 1970s as ways to criticize the communist movement and rethink radical left politics. And from that, we would say, okay, let's read the more philosophical books. We would read Poulanges in light of Althusser and not vice versa in a certain way. Think of this as a kind of a common, let's say, left, radical left communist paradigm, in opposition to readings of Poulanges as Eurocommunist. So yeah, this is a particularity of the Greek situation. It is true that there was a silencing of Althusser in the 1980s and 90s, especially in France also. That had to do, I think, with a certain climate in France, which a climate one might say of, I would describe as a theoretical anti-communism, not just anti-Marxism. So it was kind of deleting. There was always a problematic reception initial reception in the English-speaking world, because the first reception, although Althusser is especially through New Left Review, is very early on, basic texts are translated, they're available. Some of the early English-speaking, let's say, Althusserian currents are rather theoreticist. For example, if you look at theoretical practice, the British-based 1970s Althusserian journal, it does sound kind of abstract and theoreticist, and also move to other directions. And it's also the problem of the English-speaking world, which did not have, let's say, the debates in the communist movement that were somehow external. People knew about these debates, and many people, but they did not have a communist tradition. And Althusser came from a Marxist communist tradition. And this is a specific historicity, specific, let's say, terms of a debate. So I think this can explain the original, unease in regards to Althusser. And we also have to note that English-speaking Marxism gradually became more theoretical. It's later that you start having the big, important, let's say, more philosophical production of English-speaking Marxism. But I have to indeed, but as Michael mentioned, books, for example, like Alex Kalinikos, small book in the 1970s, it's a good book from that period. It's a good, interesting reading. And also there were patients like Ted Benton, who one might disagree, but it was a good book in a certain way. It was an attentive reading of Althusser. And there were also some other, let's say, more peripheral figures. I would mention Walt Sachting in Australia, an important figure of, let's say, Althusserianism in the 1970s.
He's very
sophisticated. Yeah, so they were, but I...
Yeah, I was just going to say...
Yeah, you're a very sophisticated reader. Sophisticated
theoretically. You know, he really took up theory, I think in a very creative way.
Sachting was very... influential to a small groups of Australian thinkers, and to give an example. At the same time, however, readings of Althusser continued in Latin America. There's an entire new tradition. Althusser would always mention in his correspondence that, for example, Martha Harnecker, the late Martha Harnecker, a very important figure, a theorist by herself, her small book, Basic Notions of Historical Materialism, was printed in hundreds of thousands of copies all over Latin America in the 60s and 70s. She was a student from Althusser, and it's influenced by Althusser. Althusser is mentioned in the reference. So Latin America is a different story. I think that, of course, you have Gregory Eliot, since you mentioned. Gregory Eliot did something really important. He wrote a very good monograph on Althusser in the 1980s. It's his PhD, of course. It was printed. It was good. I mean, I have disagreements with his reading. I mentioned my disagreements in the book, but at the same time, the 1980s, it was an important contribution. And then, of course, you had figures like Michael Springer, or slightly later, Warren Montag, also writing on Althusser. So you start to have, gradually from the 1990s, you start to have readings of Althusser. The appearance of the unpublished manuscripts helped, although initially, and also in the US, you had the tradition of rethinking Marxism. This is an important current. One might have disagreements or agreements, but they also had a constant reference to Althusser. So I think that the first wave, you have then a second wave, 1990s, early 2000s, around the unpublished texts, which is more philosophical, aleatory materialism, and really interesting readings, and you can see a younger generation turning to Althusser. People, let's say, of my generation, people like Bill Lewis or Jason Reed, just to mention people that started reading Althusser in the 1990s and produced their books early 2000s. And you can also see other figures in Europe, like there's an entire Italian school, for example, Maria Turchetto, Vittorio Morfino. Mm-hmm. And then in the 2000s, since you're starting to having a kind of a new reemergence of political radicalism, so Althusser is began again to be read in a certain way, also in a more political way. And you can see a growing interest in Althusser. This was helped also by the publication of the translations that Verso had started having, the translations by G.M. Gosgarian. And Gosgarian is not only a person who has a very impressive knowledge of the Althusserian archive, since he's one of the main editors of unpublished books, manuscripts, and translators into English. At the same time, Gusgarin was really important in stressing two aspects. One, that the materialism of the encounter, that is radical anti-teleology, is the guiding thread of the entire Althusser era. So this is an insistence that he stressed and repeated in the introductions he wrote for the Verso books. And secondly, that he always connected Althusser the philosopher with Althusser the militant critic of the communist movement's reformism. So I think this, so in the 2000s, younger scholars, more radicalized, more political, more open in their Marxism, would start read Althusser, read the 1960s books, read the new editions, read the introductions by Gusgarin, and I think this created an entire wave of research that is still being continued, and it's really impressive. I mean, if you know perhaps Decalage, which is a very important Althusserian review under the, let's say, the guidance of Warren Montag, although the editorial board is broader. The latest issue comes from an Althusser conference about a year ago. Most of the presentations were by young researchers, PhD students, so, and they're really good. And they revisit all these aspects and questions. And I think this tells something. I mean, because this idea that there is, people find things in Althusser, and I can see it in PhDs that come in Europe, in European universities. So people find a kind of militant, radical, materialist conception of both politics and philosophy in Althusser. And I think this is positive. And at the same time, we are now more able to have more dialogues around Althusser, for example. We can have more dialogues between Althusser and other thinkers. You mentioned Derrida. Derrida's conception of reading, in a way, eclipsed Althusser's theory of reading, although Althusser had a very specific theory. In fact, the exchange between Derrida and Althusser is significant.
Yes.
Technically, Althusser was Derrida's teacher. At the same time, Althusser will always refer to his theoretical debt towards Derrida. And you can see this is, for example, a terrain of a very interesting dialogue. And I mean, and we can even revisit, for example, even questions like, let's say, the relationship between Althusser and Hegel, okay? Because I think that Althusser can help us also understand better, and he tried it in some of his interventions in the 1970s, to see that there are still Hegelian elements in Marx, but also this is a way to revisit them. And for example, we can also move beyond some of the polemics of Althusser. I think that, for example, Althusser, as I mentioned, I try to suggest this in the book, Althusser is compatible with Gramsci, and not even in the sense of the core of Gramsci's supposed historicism, because if you look at what Gramsci describes a historicism, it's not a kind of teleology, it's a very materialist conception, very close to Althusser's conception of materialism. And I think this, for example, is a line of reasoning that's worth to be followed. Or to give another example, regards to readings of Capital. For example, all the new wave of readings of, you know, the social of the value form traditionally use Hegelian vocabulary because this seems to be more helpful. I think that is possible. And you can see it, for example, in Germany, in Michael Heinrich's reading of the value form that you can have. It's compatible with an Althusserian conception of materialism, a theory of the value of the family form. So I think that we can now have much broader dialogues around Althusser and see the fecundity and the importance of his thinking in many ways and forms.
Although perhaps ironically, in terms of the current movement back to reading Capital, it's David Harvey's approach that seems to dominate to the point of not excluding the Althusserian readings that have maybe been dominant in the 70s. From what I see here, at least, people are overwhelmingly a Harvey-esque kind of reading people in the and are often ignorant of the other side. Although, as you say, on all these other questions, there is obviously a resurgence of Althusserian approaches and interests.
But it's interesting, if philologically, in a certain way, that if you look at Reading Capital is a seminar held in 1964-1965, and it's a seminar that goes into at the center of Reading Capital, reading the value form. You have Jacques Rancière's text, which is one might say an Althusser influenced theory of fetishism, reading of Marx's theory of fetishism, and Althusser's also idea of what is the scientific revolution of Marx, how it is there is a radical break between Marx's theory of value and classical political economy. This is a very original reading. This is before the value form debate. This is before Backhaus writing his seminal text that opened the German debate. This is before the appearance of the translation of Rubin's book in early 1970s. So you have a value or even value form intervention, one might say, avant la lettre, in the 1960s. So I think this is it's by itself it is interesting. Of course, there was always the problem, I have to mention that unfortunately the full translation of Reading Capital came in 2015. And for many years, this idea was that there was only the edition with only Althusser's texts and Balibar's texts, so the others were not available. But by itself, it's an impressive, taking into consideration that, with the exception of Althusser, who was in his 1940s, the other students are students in their 20s, late 20s, or
in
even
early 20s. Balibar
was 20, 22, 23. So you're impressed.
Wrote The Basic Problems of Historical Materialism. He was 24. Yeah.
24.
So, Bonnie, I think the big difference between Althusser's reading of Capital and why it's much more profound is he reads Capital. How do we read him as philosophers? Harvey does not read Capital philosophically. You know, Althusser is looking at concept formation. He's looking at, you know, how the conditions for the production of that knowledge is really taking place. Whereas Harvey gives it's expository. And this is maybe why it's popular. Althusser is a struggle to read. It's not easy. The difference in a certain way.
But there's also surprisingly not much of a dialogue between the two sides.
Rick Wolf, in a way, you know, he had the great book on knowledge in class with Steve Resnick, which was an attempt to do in the American field and Amherst, the Marxist epistemology. Today, Rick is they basically doing basic populist accounts of understanding Marxism. So this is something that the audience, you know, the audience is very different in 1960 in a certain way. There's a very different level of struggle as well as education at that point, right? You know, Balibar, Althusser, they knew poetry, they knew film, they knew, you know, they knew the music, they knew all these things together, right? That they brought to the table, to their work. You know, they were not overly, you know, technicized or, you know, specialized intellectuals in many ways. This is the interesting part, to my mind. You know, as you know, Althusser had great interest in painting and in theater, especially. And that Montag has, I think, written a book about Althusser and the relationship to theatricality and the theater, you know, that's been under theorized as well. So I think that opens up a whole new, another kind of a possibility, you know, not so narrow, you know. With all due respect to David Harvey, there's a great service going on, but I think there's a different level there. You know, how does this concept, and how, what is value to begin with, to ask that philosophical question? You know, what, you know, in a sense, right? Which was a debate at the New School with people as orthodox as Anwar Sheikh. You know, we used to go to Sheikh's class. You're fetishizing certain categories in your rigorous orthodox reading of Capital as a political economist. But anyway, that's my little, you know, short intervention here. I think you're really right about his, I mean, you know, it's something really worth talking about often, that the philosopher's role in the modern, you know, or in the postmodern or whatever post-structuralist moment is really intervention. And Althusser understood this so well politically, you know, that you needed to be involved in this very much. And as you well know, with the assassination of Cabral, you know, the advent of Eurocommunism, the historical compromise in Italy during the 70s in Europe, Althusser had good reason to be engaged in polemics with this trend towards, you know, parliamentary, you know, socialism, and of course, Eurocommunism, and what was happening at that time, and, you know, which led to, you know, what we just published in Situations, The Crisis of the Parties by Poulantzas. So, yeah. You know, this was a kind of crucial decade, if you will, for political intervention and
practice. Oh, no, it's important to say that this is the last major Marxist-inspired debate. The yep. debate on the state and politics in the second half of the 1970s, which includes Althusser, Balibar, Poulantzas. It includes their Italian interlocutors, from Pietro Ingrao to Rosanna Rosanda and others. And many others that are sure. And also so it's an important moment. Now, to be fair, historically, Althusser tried to intervene politically, although this was also one of his limits. He was never a kind of political a leader of a tendency or something like that. He was a militant. He was a member of the French Communist Party. He was very active, but he couldn't think the kind of political rupture that was in a certain way in the order of the day. He couldn't leave the party. He couldn't think of a new political form outside the party. And if I to give an example of that, if you read Machiavelli and Us, the book, which is a fantastic book, and it's the basic idea that you need, in a certain way, we need a kind of a new political endeavor, a new prince. So it's obvious that the only possible translation of it is that you need a new communist movement, a new political movement, right. to create the conditions of a possible good encounter and social change in the French context. And Althusser could not do that, or even suggest that. And perhaps this is one of the reasons he decided not to publish this manuscript, because it comes like a natural, let's say, in the end, conclusion that, okay, what we need is a new political form. This was his limit. And one might see that even in the debates he chooses to intervene. Take, for example, the debate on the dictatorship of the proletariat. By itself, it's a very important debate. It's because it's not, as he said, you cannot delete notions. And if in Marxism, the dictatorship of the proletariat is a scientific or a theoretical notion, you cannot easily delete it. At the same time, one might say, but this is a kind of dogmatic and pedantic. I mean, it's just a phrase. So, but Althusser tried to use it as a metonymy for the lack of, let's say, of a revolutionary strategy. But the way he tried to articulate it was both at the same time, you know, interesting, incisive, at the same time, it sounded like dogmatism to the ears of many persons. So this, one might also see his his limitations. But I think that he had an acute understanding of the political stakes of these debates. For example, that to give just one example, Poulenc's theory of the state is incredibly rich. And in a certain way, state power and socialism is the more complex and well-articulated conception of all the aspects, all the functioning of the state we have available in the Marxist tradition, at least the classical Marxist tradition, because in an idea, the state that is relational, class struggle intervenes at all levels. The state is not only oppression and not only ideology, it also produces strategies, discourses. It produces history and produces the state, the nation state. It's a very good, very, very fascinating book, which deserves to be well reread. At the same time, Poulenc just sort of jumps to the conclusion. What we need a strategy for democratic socialism, leaving aside all the caution that might have been necessary in order to avoid the shortcomings of a parliamentary conception of politics and the confrontation, what it means to actually change, transform the state in a revolutionary way. If you look at Althusser's writings from that period, they seem, and I stress seem, they are not necessarily, more simple, simplistic. Althusser has this idea, the state, we need to keep the idea that the state is a machine. Machine seems like a mechanistic conception of the state. As opposed to, Poulenc just saying the state is the material condensation of a relation of forces.
Right.
But why does he choose the notion of the machine? He suggests that machine, it transforms social force into, legal forms and political power. I felt very fascinated because it points to how the state is a material condensation with the emphasis on material. Because if you have a condensed materially, in a certain way, social relations, and then you have an apparatus. Then you have something that is in a certain way a machine.
Right.
And why it's important to keep that in mind, because it points to the question of rupture. It points to the transportation should necessarily be violent in the sense of physical violence necessarily, but in the sense of very strong, very profound transformation. So you can see how Althusser had really important insights. He could not perhaps bring them to the full conclusion, and he's in the last month, or let's say last year before the tragedy of 1980, when, as we all know, he tragically killed his own partner and wife for many, many years. He was not condemned to a penal service. He was judged that it was as part of his mental state, etc. But it was nevertheless a tragedy. But if you look at his final interventions in the months preceding this event, his Althusser is really in a question of increased political anxiety.
Yes.
He's very, very critical of the classical communist movement. He gives this interview in Italian television, which says, "I'm also sort of an anarchist," etc., etc. It's obvious that he had reached a limit.
Yes,
he had this the limit, let's say, of his Leninism, but at the same time, his insights are still useful if you go back at that debate.
Mm-hmm.
One of the first examples, Panagiotis, you give of bending the stick the other way, of intervening in the political debates of the day, was vis-a-vis the student movement in France in the 60s that attempted to democratize the university. And in opposition to Rancière and I'm sure many others, Althusser had what must have appeared at that time a much more conservative position, which is that you cannot eliminate alienation. You cannot negate the difference in power between faculty and students, or between people who know, in a sense, and people who are learning don't know as much in a sense, and that's inherently a power differential. And thus he was opposed to those proposed reforms to try to put the students and the professors on some kind of a more equal footing.
This
seems relevant today to many debates happening today vis-a-vis the universities and the various tendencies.
And of course, you're aware of his great theoretical antagonist that you mentioned, Kojève. When Kojève was asked by the students, what can we do to become more radical? He said, learn ancient Greek. So that was his response to the moment. Very much like Althusser, in a way, they still wanted, you know, some notion of a hierarchy, right?
This is a very interesting debate that you mentioned. This is 1964. There are these first waves of student protests, mainly centered and around questions of democratization, kind of egalitarian, challenging the authority of professors, etc., etc. There was also a kind of very specific French context that those opinions were represented from the, let's say, the more right Italian looking towards the Italian Communist Party wing of the youth of the Communist Party. Althusser students were more to the left, to the other side. You're right. Althusser was suggesting that you cannot have, a naive conception of dealing away with actual material, differences and contradictions. But it's also important, and I'm saying this because this is research being done by people working in the archive, that at the same period, this prompted the Althusserian group into a highly original research in the questions of education, which is perhaps we'll try thinking of ways to, you know, publishing it or translating it. There's at least a book by an Italian scholar, Giacomo Custodi, on that. We'll probably try to translate it in English, which deals with unpublished exchanges within the Althusserian group on schools, on education. And you can see how their position evolves, their dialogue and confrontation with Bourdieu, and which at the same period was already a major figure on these questions, and how you can see all these elements, on the one hand, contributing to Althusser's conception of the ideological apparatus of the state. Part of this research appears. And other parts of this research appear as Christian Baudelot and Etablé, L'école capitaliste en France, a book that in France it was very influential, although not translated as far as I know in any other. It was translated in Italian. In English, it was never translated. So you can see the Althusser group trying to articulate a new vocabulary of a Marxist critique of education, because this is the period when things are first being debated. This is interesting. But as you're right, Althusser would always bend the stick to the other side. He would take this kind of theoretical risks. He did the same with the notion of the dictatorship of the proletariat, as already mentioned, and he would even do that when he would go and say in 1977 at the Venice conference organized by the Il Manifesto group, he will say, finally, the crisis of Marxism has erupted. And he says, this is a good thing that we finally have the crisis of Marx. He actually means the crisis of the communist, the communist movement. But so he would always do this. He always had this idea of intervening, try to move things, change the balance of forces. This, of course, had risks, had costs, and you can see it in all the tensions running through his writings.
But it seems to me, to the question of what would be an Althusserian politics, or is there an Althusserian politics, this dimension would necessarily be part of it. And I think Zizek and others have pointed to this too. The idea, for example, that alienation is constitutive of all societies, or ideology is constitutive of all societies. So the radical movement is not to eliminate alienation. You know, you cannot eliminate alienation in the university or outside the university, certainly. But it points to a kind of radical self-awareness of this fact. And then there are certain, then other possibilities maybe that opens up. But it seems that would be certainly a key component of any definition of Althusserian politics. But in the recent past, of course, we have seen Althusserians in politics with a varied array of political positions, none of which are easily reducible to the ideas or the contributions of Althusserian Marxism. You know, the obvious example, number one, would be there was a minister of education in Greece, speaking of education, Baltas, who is, of course, a very serious and a very good scholar of Althusser, an Althusserian epistemologist and philosopher, from which that position you could not easily deduce then, you know, what happened, let's say, or what decisions were made while in office.
Yeah, this is, well, as the saying goes, in Greece, we are Althusser in the Greek left was a little bit like Hegel in the German debates of the 1830s. We have Althusserians of the left and Althusserians of the right in a certain way. But yes, you're right. I mean, I don't know. If I would think of what are the characteristic traits of a potential politics influenced by Althusser, I would suggest it is the idea of politics and also thinking about politics as intervention in a terrain that is always already in a certain way determined. You never start with a clean slate. You always intervene in contradictions that are already active. It is the idea of the need for constant self-criticism and correction. And it is what is most difficult, perhaps, but also the more important question in regards to communist politics is, how can you think politics under the conjuncture, its open dynamics, and the possibility of the encounter? How can you do politics when by itself there is this very strong sense of contingency involved? Yeah. And I think this idea of how to be at this, because one way is to go a little bit like Badiou. There's no linkage between what you do politically and whether the event will arrive. If the event, you know, emerges in a miracle kind of way, then you have to express fidelity to it. But until then, you just do politics at a distance from the state, but there's no causal relation. So if you do not want to avoid that, and you not have a kind of historicist fantasy that you are actually creating the future now, then I think I would suggest this, the idea, how do you create conditions for encounters? How do you think of your politics as ways to prepare for the unexpected, to create conditions for the unexpected, which in a certain way combines both the longue durée and, you know, the immediate response to something that emerges. This is the power and the tragedy of communist politics in a certain way, because you need both the patience to keep on keeping on, even, you know, dynamics seem not to be very positive, but at the same time to be able to realize that if an encounter emerges, if a conjuncture emerges that can have a potential, it is always premature. Conditions are never ripe. This is the motto we should have, in terms, not in the sense of a voluntarism,
yes,
but in the sense that when conditions arrive, they arrive in a very quick, unexpected way. And so you have, in a certain way, to be prepared for this, although in fact you're never prepared for this. So I would suggest this is a kind of
Luxembourg on this. So it would be kind of a left Luxembourgist sensibility.
Yeah, but I would suggest it's both a left Luxembourg, but also I think Gramsci is very useful on that. If you combine this with a kind of war of position, not as a long way through the institutions and all these reformist conceptions of, but as the idea that you create conditions of hegemonic politics by working, grassroots organizing, creating elements of a different civilization, experimenting with new social forms, while at the same time maintaining an open eye for any conjecture that might lead to rapture. So I think this is a way to deal with it. And yes, in a certain way, yes, there is a Luxembourgish element into that, this idea of the party as process in a certain way. I would think
that you have to fail before you can, failures are not failures.
Before we conclude, because we're been a long time. I mean, it's good. It's great. We could go on another, 4 or 5 hours, but for our viewers and listeners, it's probably, we've done a lot today. But I wanted to mention one thing or ask you about one aspect of the book that seems to be excluded, is the importance of Auguste Cornu to Althusser in terms of the early readings of historical materialism. It seems to me that this was one of the masters, right, that has been a forgotten figure in the history of the French left and interventions on historical materialism. And that combined with Bachelard and others, in terms of the rupture and the so-called epistemological break, very important. And I didn't really see much, despite your comprehensiveness, any real engagement with Cornu, and I hardly ever see it at all in any of the literature on Althusser. And it seems to me this was a very seminal figure to him in the early going. So for whatever you have to offer there.
Yeah, well, you're right, but I would say that for reasons that had to do with how I tried to bring together material for this book, which was not designed as a comprehensive monograph on Althusser, the epistemological aspects of Althusser, this was an aspect that is underdeveloped in the book, or basically it is, one might say, even absent. Okay. So because this is a very important research, because Althusser, when he attempts to rethink these philosophical questions, he draws from a very important epistemological tradition in France, which by itself is a very important page in the history of philosophy and epistemology in the 20th century. This idea, because Althusser, I stress in my book that he's anti-humanist and anti-historicist. He's also anti-empiricist.
Yes, absolutely.
And Althusser is anti-empiricist in a very original way, because he says that knowledge is not something that you extract, it's something that is reflected. Yes. Knowledge is something that is produced. This is a very Spinozist, anti-empiricist conception, that knowledge is the outcome of conceptual transformations of a production process in a certain way, which I think it's very, very important. In a certain way, it moves beyond the idealism versus rationalism divide line, and it's much more than a simple constructivist approach. It's an idea of production of knowledge, not of construction. But this is something that I do not develop in the book, but perhaps I should in other texts.
Yes, good. And also the relationship he had with Tran Vac Tho, the great Vietnamese philosopher, Phenomenology and Dialectical Materialism.
Yeah. This is also, the debate around phenomenology is also one that should be revisited.
Yes.
Because it is by itself also an important page in the intellectual climate of the 1960s. It's not just an opposition. It's more complex than that. And to be fair, Warren Montag's book does a very good job of exactly reconstructing this ideological and theoretical climate of the early 1960s, exactly to point that even what we tend to read as structuralism, and I don't mean about Althusser in general in the French context, is much more complex than a stereotypical later conceptualization of structuralism does. But this is also something that needs more work.
Yes. But I mean, again, thank you so much. And I won't use the word comprehensive again, but you know, you at least point to Deleuze's intervention too, or what does it mean to be a structuralist? It's very, yeah, very-
A great text by-
regard, so you added that. So anyway, anything else, Peter, Comrade Bratsis, to say?
Well, there's a lot, but we have no time, so we have to-
Time limit.
We have to leave it. We'll do one in the summer altogether. Yes. You know, yes. It'll be it won't be windows like this. It'll be a different kind of articulation of the whole than this one.
Underneath the Greek moon, right? Hopefully with no airstrike.
With moonshine and a different feel.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can even smoke if you want.
The party, as you know, when I first met Balibar, he talked about how he got kicked out of the party because he wrote a piece called Open Your Windows, Comrades. And this was, late, he got kicked out. He left. He didn't leave on his own accord. He actually set it up so he would be kicked out, in a sense. So it's kind of interesting in that moment. But we thank you so much. This was great. Extremely knowledgeable and pointed and very focused. And we thank you so much for this. And I thank you personally for such a really great intervention in your book. And I will certainly, we'll review it for situations, which, we have all of two readers. No, we have more readers than that, but we'll certainly try to get it out there. And I hope we can put together a small gathering for the Left Forum, come to New York again, and we do a panel on this.
Yeah, that would be great. Yeah,
we could probably pack the room. Definitely. So that'll be a lot of fun going forward. And I'll see you in Greece. And thank you, as usual. Thank you also.
Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Peter, thank you. My co-host, Peter Bratsis, and our producer, Josh Calbo. This is Michael Pelias saying thank you, everybody, for listening. Our special thanks to Panagiotis for producing such a great book and taking the time to explicate it and open up some questions that it raises. So thank you so much, and we'll see you for Prosperity Marxism number 21 soon.
There is a war between the rich and poor, a war between the man and the woman. There is a war between the ones who say there is a war and the ones who say that there isn't. Why don't you come on back to the war? That's right, get in it. Why don't you come on back to the war? It's just beginning.